Did you guys see the MKBHD video where he did a blind taste test letting people choose their favorite photo out of all the different smartphones on the market? People's favorite images were all based on things like exposure, color, contrast, and that's all stuff that is really easy to edit after you took the photo. So let's make your photos look great whatever phone you shot it on. We run a photo and video production company, creating content using DSLRs and mirrorless and cinema cameras, but cell phones are still the point and shoots of our lives. So this is where like some of the most important photos get taken, our family photos, things that we really care about. So let's make these photos look as good as they used to in the film days. Let's start by correcting your photos. If they look wrong, then presets don't matter. They're gonna look like crap anyway. We always start by adjusting exposure first, and I'm gonna do that in the Photos app just to show you why I never use the Photos app. The slider just does not look good. It makes everything feel very HDR, and you can break it into more detail here, but I just don't like the algorithms that Apple uses, so we're gonna use some very different apps. And these concepts apply to Android or iOS, so don't worry about it. I'm gonna start by using VSCO, because that's my favorite. And you can see that as we jump into this exposure slider, even if I go all the way up, it still looks pretty natural. It doesn't screw with the saturation, it doesn't make it look fake. It's just an organic move up or down. That's super important to me. So for this image, I'm gonna go to about 2. And when you're adjusting exposure, there isn't really a right or wrong answer. So in this selfie, it's pretty accurate, but I would just choose to go a little bit brighter on our faces. And sometimes you're gonna find that the background or foreground is way brighter or darker than your subject, but all that matters is the subject of the photo. That needs to look correct. This photo illustrates it really well. There's this little spotlight coming in and lighting up Charlie and Anya here. The background can be dark, that's not a problem. I don't need to go until everything's bright because they get overexposed. So I'm just gonna go up just a little bit until I find that like their skin tones and fur tones look about right. Once you're happy with the exposure of your image, you're gonna look at the white balance, which is the warmth or coolness of the photo, the oranginess, the blueness, however you wanna describe it, but that controls most of the color of the image. You'll also find there's often a tint setting. This usually only corrects things like fluorescent lights. You don't have to change it as much. The most important one is the actual temperature, and in this one, I'm gonna go a little bit warmer for sunrise. Save that, and now let's do that to another photo that needs it even more. So something that happens often is that the snow will become very cool in the shadows. So in this case, it's actually a little bit blue. I'm gonna warm it up quite a bit, but wait, first step, I gotta do my exposure. It's a bit too dark. So now I can really see what my tones are doing. I'm gonna go up quite a bit on this. Now we're gonna do white balance and probably bring it up, I don't know, 2. 2 isn't a number I choose all the time. It just happens to look right for these. Actually, okay, we'll go even brighter on the exposure. Because sometimes once I see the image on white, it looks pretty different from black. So it's important to see the white and the black points against different backgrounds. When you're just getting started, white balance can be a hard thing to judge. So I find it really useful to pull up other reference photos next to it. Just pictures taken in a similar setting. So if it was outdoors, then find an outdoors photo. Yours is indoors, find another indoors photo. And just get the colors looking kind of the same, like they're in the same world. And that not only helps with the photo you're working on, but trains your eye for the future so you know what to look for. Next, we'll look at straightening and cropping. This may seem like something to skip, because like, okay, you took the photo, fine, whatever, but you can fix a lot of compositional mistakes by doing this, or just make the photo feel more intentional. So if your photo is just a little bit off, left or right, tilted in one way or the other, it'll always look like a mistake. Nobody will think you did that on purpose. So just doing those little tweaks, like right now I'm looking at that center line, I want it to be straight up and down. That stuff really is what will bring your photos to looking more professional. Again, I'm looking at the vertical lines on this one. And let's look at what cropping can do. So in this image, I found that the rule of thirds, which, you know, you put things into the grid like this you're seeing right here, is really helpful for composition, but it's slightly off in this case. So I'm gonna lock the ratio to 3:4, and I'm gonna bring this in so that Anya appears in one of the thirds here. Before, she's kind of just in like a strange place. She could also be on this third line, that'd be a bit better composition, but I also want the cabin to be in the center. So if I bring her into the box of our lower thirds, then the cabin becomes in the center. And I just prefer this composition, it's a little bit stronger. Following the rule of thirds, I mean, it's not a real rule. It's not something you have to do, but it helps. All right, that's all our corrections. Now we're gonna add a preset. And a quick word about that first. All these apps that I'm showing you, I think they all cost money. I don't know if I chose any free apps here, but look, it's worth it. Honestly, you'd be better off using a cheaper phone because they all have great cameras. and using good software to edit your photos, because it's gonna make a way bigger difference. So don't try to skimp on this. It's relatively cheap. So let's open VSCO again and take a look at this photo, because it's got a lot of different things in it. And I'm just gonna start randomly flipping through some different filters here and tell you what I like to look for, and especially what I like to avoid when I'm choosing a filter, AKA a preset. So filters do a lot of different things. They're moving colors around in all sorts of ways. But one thing I always want to avoid is having the highlights or the shadows too colored, as in, you know, aggressively tinted in one direction or another. You can see it right here. The highlights are green and yellow. They're a little bit crazy. Again, here, this one will turn them all blue. This is the stuff that will make your editing age poorly. So you'll look back and you probably won't love this. This is what the early Instagram filters were doing. And I don't think we ever want to go back to that. Also, don't worry about making it look too faded or fake vintagey. Like, just make it look good. So to give you a sense of what I do like, I'm gonna go into my favorites here, and you're gonna find that all of these give it a relatively neutral treatment. Like, some of them are very strong. A lot of them either add contrast or add saturation, but they don't make the image, you know, fall apart. And if they do go too far, I can just click it and turn it down. I usually don't actually apply presets at full strength, maybe, you know, between 5 and 10. Oh, and by the way, I missed some steps here. I see that I didn't quite fix my exposure on this one. I'll bring that back up a little bit. And I also didn't straighten it. That line is not right. I'm glad I caught that there. So again, there isn't a right or wrong answer here. There are desaturated presets that look great. There are very saturated presets that also look great. But I do like to see a bit of tonal separation. So that means that blues and yellows usually get pulled apart a bit. So there's some color contrast, not just contrast. So you can see, I'll turn this preset all the way down. So we're back to neutral. If I just turn up the contrast, I don't love this look. Like, just a super contrasty image isn't great. It can be a little bit flatter. Like, that's okay. There doesn't have to be a lot of contrast in your image, but you do want to highlight some kind of differences in the image, whether that's the bright and dark parts of the image or the different colors that appear in it or not. Of course, you can break all these rules. This is just generally how I think about it. So look, I'm not going to tell you which presets to choose. Go out there and try a bunch. There are many good ones. Most of all, just don't choose the bad ones. This would be a great time to thank our sponsor, Eero, who create powerful but simple networking devices that cover your whole home or office in mesh Wi-Fi. So wherever you are, you're not getting slowdowns or dropouts or dead spots. Look, I enjoy gadgets as much as anyone else, but I am no good at networking. I find it hard and confusing. So I was really glad that when I got my Eero, it was really simple to set up. Just plug it in, run through a few steps in the app, and you're good to go. And I gotta say, the software, hardware, all of it is designed beautifully. And then it's up and running and you've got all the speed and the range that you expect out of your Wi-Fi, because we count on it a lot. I don't plug my computers in anymore. There's also Eero Plus to keep your network secure. There's ad blocking and you can protect yourself against malicious outsider attacks. And of course, amazing customer support if you need it. If great Wi-Fi sounds like something you need, then go to Eero.com/Tyler Stallman and also enter Tyler Stallman at checkout to show them that you heard about them here. But you're not just doing that out of the goodness of your heart. To show your support for this channel, you also get $100 off when you order the bundle that comes with an Eero base station, 2 beacons, and a year of Eero Plus. One more time, that's Eero.com/Tyler Stallman, and thanks to Eero for supporting the channel. And now let's talk about apps. There are a million apps in the store, so which are the good ones? I'm gonna show you some of my favorites. I've got a whole grid of stuff here that, you know, if you see it on the screen, I've used it at some point, but I don't use all of them regularly, so I'm just gonna talk about my favorites. You've already seen VSCO. It does have some major competitors. A lot of people also like Darkroom. We're gonna look at that in a minute. And Afterlight, which is kind of similar, but I don't really use it. I just know that it looks fine. And of course, if you want to pull out the big guns, there's Lightroom CC, which is amazingly powerful, a bit out of the scope of this video, but it is a really great app. Metafo is a metadata app that lets you see specific information about the photos that you take. There's Google Photos, which gives you an unlimited backup of everything, but the files are compressed, so it's kind of just a safety net. There's Gemini, and this helps you find duplicate photos or similar photos that you can go through and just kind of get rid of duplicates really quickly. Retouch, it's my favorite way to remove objects from the background of photos, like Photoshop style. Lens distortions, this adds lens flares, lighting effects, fake snow, fake fog, like all these different things that can look kind of fake, so be careful with it. Tezza is an app from a friend of Anya's that is a blogger, and I don't use this app, but Anya likes it. It kind of over compresses your files, but the filters are nice. Also, Filmborn is a good film emulation. Snapseed, you've probably heard of it. I don't really use it anymore. There's gonna be links to all these in the description below, so on your way to that Eero URL, you can also pick up some apps too. And if you've hung in here this long, you're gonna see my favorite part. We're gonna break down what is in what I think to be a good preset or how to kind of just build your own. And this time we're gonna use Darkroom because it's got some nice HSL sliders. So we're gonna skip the filters, we don't need theirs. We're gonna go straight to curves and we're gonna add a little bit of contrast. So if you don't know how a curve works, the left side is the dark pixels in the image and the right side is the bright. So I'm gonna bring down the darker side and bring up the brighter side a little bit, and that's what contrast is. As well, I'm gonna make sure that the darkest parts come up just a little bit. If you bring them up a lot, it becomes like a vintage fade. That's not at all what we're looking for. We don't want this to look fade. We basically want to bring the blacks up the smallest amount that we can, just so it opens up the shadows a little bit. So even while we have that additional contrast, there's still some detail you can see. Same thing in the highlights. We're gonna bring the top of the highlights down just a little bit. And what you can see that's doing that I think is really important is it's taking away the clip in those highlights. Can you see that there's that light blue where it transitions to suddenly being white? Like there's almost a hard line. That's what digital does, and film had a much smoother roll off. So we can roll that off ourselves by just bringing down the highlights a little bit. And now looking at the subject of my photo, it's that guy in the middle. I'm gonna bring him up a little bit because I think he's a little bit too dark. So that's a decent contrast profile. We can do a few more things with curves. Like if we go into the reds, you can, you know, cool down the shadows and warm up the highlights. That's a pretty common thing. I don't do it that often, but we're doing it today because you might want to. And that actually boosted the overall contrast too much, so I'm gonna take it back down a little bit in our overall luminance curve. But if all that seemed a bit too complicated, I'm gonna reset it, and you can actually just go in and you can just like boost the contrast a little bit and bring up the brightness and bring down the highlights. Actually, no, wait, you'd bring down the whites. See, they don't have a white slider. Maybe I'll do the fade just a little bit to take that edge off the shadow and highlights. That's the easier way to do it. Okay, if you don't like the tone thing here, that's the simple way. Now let's go into HSL sliders. This is where you create like a real color profile, and this is really what gives it a film look, not the other stuff. Well, some of the other stuff. But this is something I think that takes a little bit longer for people to figure out, but is so worth it and really move you forward. This stuff applies to most images. I'm not gonna explain exactly why I'm doing it, but I'm gonna start by grabbing the blues and I'm gonna bring their luminance down a little bit and move the hue towards the green or the cyan. In the greens, I'm gonna move that quite a bit towards the cyan. I like the trees and the foliage to look a little cooler. And a good trick that it's not in this photo, but if there's a human that was really prominent in it, is if you move the red and orange to be closer together, so the orange becomes more red, the red becomes more orange, that'll take a lot of like blotchiness and blemishes out of skin. And actually these trees look better with the yellows moving towards orange. You'll often find that what you thought was green is really yellow. And of course, the fact this isn't straight is driving me crazy. And so that's it. Without a preset, we have edited our image and made it look kind of like film. And a side note, always remember, like, film isn't a magical thing. It's just that they spent so long developing the colors in them, they look better than digital. Like, digital is a bit more realistic, but film is more beautiful. That's why we're trying to emulate it, not to make it look old. But if this still wasn't enough for you and you want to learn more, go to stallmanpodcast.com. I have professional photographers and YouTubers on there, and we go through all this stuff in so much more detail. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video.